Tomorrow, on Thursday the 12th of December, the people of Britain will be asked to make a momentous decision in a general election which, frankly, has been the dirtiest, the most vicious election campaign, I think, in the history of modern Britain. I believe that in order to find anything remotely resembling this, you'd have to go back to the year 1924, to the notorious Zinoviev letter scandal, which brought down the Labour government at that time. But even if you were to compare that avalanche of lies, I think that it pales in insignificance in comparison to the avalanche, the torrent, the tsunami of lies and distortions and misrepresentations and sheer slander that has been heaped on the Labour Party in recent weeks. By our wonderful free press, so-called. I don't know what they're free from. Free from telling the truth. Free from the influence of big business? Hardly. But free from any semblance of shame in the way that they have viciously denigrated and attacked the Labour leader, Jeremy Corbyn. I think you'd be hard-pressed to find any example in recent decades, in recent history, for a smear campaign, an organised, orchestrated, deliberate campaign of smear directed against one individual, as has been directed against Jeremy Corbyn. In the press, in the media, in the newspapers, every day, every evening, every broadcast, every news coverage, specifically designed only for one thing, to discredit and undermine one man, the leader of the Labour Party, Jeremy Corbyn. In order to conduct this campaign, they've even called in the aid of a rather important individual, the Almighty. Yes, oh yes, yes. The chief rabbi's services have been called into action to add his voice of denunciation to this man. Incidentally, I just discovered that the Wiesenthal Center recently published a report in which they said, get a load of this, just sit back in case you fall down, that in the entire world, out of about 2,000 anti-Jewish, anti-Semitic incidents or whatever, the most dangerous, the most appalling was that of, guess what, Jeremy Corbyn's Labour Party in Britain. Now, you will forgive me, perhaps I've got a nasty, suspicious mind. But you see, this so-called anti-Semitic smear, because that's what it is, a smear without any content, no real evidence or content behind it whatsoever, is orchestrated in a very strange way, in a very orchestrated, deliberate, very effective way, I might add, which frankly makes me suspicious that maybe there's some kind of invisible hand behind this campaign. And I think that this invisible hand could quite well be traced back to Israeli Secret Service, the Mossad, who are quite effective people, in an attempt to prevent Jeremy Corbyn, with his record, of course, of support for the Palestinians, ever coming to power in Britain. But there we are, that's just a suspicion which I will not insist upon. Oh, and of course, immediately they all piled in, all the rest of the God's squad immediately piled in. The Archbishop of Canterbury, yes, the Jewish there, of course, I've mentioned. And even the Hindus have been involved in Modi, that ultra-reactionary right-wing element in India, has organized his forces in order to discredit the Labour Party and prevent a Labour victory in Britain. All that was missing was the Jehovah Witnesses and the Flat Earth Society, and then you really would have been in business. Yes, but in spite of all this vile abuse and slanders and smears, despite all this colossal campaign, this deafening campaign, it's completely one-sided, by the way. The role of the media has been particularly scandalous in that respect. You can contrast the hard-hitting attacks on Corbyn when he's attempted to speak on television to the kid-glove treatment of Boris Johnson when he has been in interviews. In fact, he's so reluctant to have interviews at all that I read in this morning papers, quite astonishingly, that he took refuge in the refrigerator in order to avoid being interviewed by Piers Morgan, I think it was, on the BBC, on the radio. A large fridge, I might add, not a small one, a large refrigerator, followed by all his team of advisors. One of whom was, I think, alleged to have said something like, oh, fucking hell, or words to those, excuse my French, words to those that effect. Yes, a massive, unprecedented comment, and yet, oh, by the way, I've forgotten the most important element in this campaign. Yesterday, the news was full, the TVs were full of a statement, a scandalous interview by John Ashworth, a member of Labour's shadow cabinet. I don't know how the hell somebody like that, a Blairite like that, could be included in one of Corbyn's cabinet. We'll have to take this up very seriously after the election. A vicious tirade against the Labour Party and against Jeremy Corbyn, a defeatist by one of the main spokesmen, Labour's shadow health spokesman, attacking Corbyn, attacking the Labour Party and so on. So, you see, all I can say is, in a sense, we should thank Mr. Ashworth, we should thank John Ashworth, because he has revealed, he has let slip, the mask has slipped. And what he is saying, what all the other right-wing fifth columnists and proto-Tories in the parliamentary Labour Party are actually thinking, all these ladies and gentlemen, every single one of them, is actually wanting and wishing and working for a Labour defeat. They want Labour to be defeated because a Corbyn victory, of course, would undermine the position, whereas what they really want to do is not to defeat the Tories or Boris Johnson, but to defeat the main enemy, which, of course, is Jeremy Corbyn. Now, with this avalanche of gangsters ganging up on the Labour leader, one would imagine that Labour wouldn't stand a cat's chance in hell. It's no wonder, by the way, that the polls gave a big majority to the Tories. It's no wonder that even Boris Johnson was extremely unpopular, for obvious reasons, one would have thought. He's more popular, that Jeremy Corbyn, rather, is even more unpopular than Boris Johnson, so they say. And so John Ashworth, of course, obligingly repeats. One would have thought that Labour wouldn't stand a cat's chance in hell. And yet, for reasons which the pundits find utterly incomprehensible, in the recent weeks and days, indeed, as the election approaches, as election day comes, the moment of decision arrives, the gap has been systematically decreased. The gap between Labour and Tories have been decreased to the extent where now they're talking about the possibility of a hung parliament, which would contain, by the way, the danger from their point of view, from the standpoint of the big business and the capitalists and bankers who really run this affair and run the nation, of course, irrespective of who's in number 10 Downing Street. It fills them with fear and panic. Oh yes, I can detect an element of a note of panic in the conduct of Johnson and his advisors, including the incident of the refrigerator. It's because they're in a state of blue funk, because despite all their attacks, they have failed. You see, Labour is recovering on the basis of a left-wing programme, which indicates something about the real mood that exists among people in Britain, who are fed up after 10 years of constant attacks, reduction in living standards, vicious conservative austerity, attacks on the national health. The picture of this poor young kid that was on the floor of Leeds General Hospital, which shocked the nation. The same day, by the way, that photograph appeared, a good friend of mine, who was due for a serious cancer operation. His operation was cancelled when he was on the trolley waiting to go into the operating theatre, having done all the preliminaries and so on. Cancelled why? Lack of beds. So the national health is in crisis, is in danger. No matter what they say, of course, it's complete lies. The American big pharmaceutical companies, they're licking their lips, they're licking their chops, they're rubbing their hands at the prospect of a Conservative government which would open up the national health, of course, to privatisation. You better believe it. But leave that to one side. Despite all these things, there has been a reaction in favour of Labour in recent weeks and days, indeed, particularly among the youth. All the opinion polls agree that the great majority of young people in Britain fervently desire a change. Who can blame them? and indeed are swinging behind the Labour Party in droves, in masses. Corbyn is the only political leader in Britain that's been able to hold big political mass meetings in different parts of the country. There's been a surge, particularly of a re-energizing, if you like, of Labour's activist base, particularly the young people, not only the young people, a surge of activist participation in the election campaign, particularly in London, but not only in London, it's throughout the country is the case. Liverpool football fans, last night, in a football match, I think it was against, an Austrian team, yes, Salzburg, I think, were actually captured on TV in the middle, this is abroad, this is not in Britain even, chanting, "Oh, Jeremy Corbyn," it was picked up on the TV screens. So even there you see the mood of the masses, which is beginning to react seriously against the Tories and the class of exploiters and parasites which they stand for. So many people have volunteered to help Labour in the election campaign tomorrow that in London, I think in Putney the other day, 700 people turned up to canvas. So many people have volunteered for election day that they've had to be redirected to the Midlands in order to go to other seats. And therefore, let nobody tell you that there is not a radicalized mood in Britain among the working class and among the youth. There is, of course, despite all the attempts to sidetrack and the nonsense of the Conservatives or get Brexit done, that was the slogan and so on. And on that note of Brexit, which has indeed confused and polarized Britain in a very unfortunate sense, let me just make a final appeal to those supporters of Brexit, there are some, quite a few, which are contemplating maybe voting Conservatives only on that issue, not because they agree with the Conservatives, they don't all agree with Boris Johnson, they certainly do not. Let me just quote you a little example from history. You may have heard of the Battle of the Boyne. That was the famous battle in the 17th century where the Protestant forces of William of Orange defeated the Catholic forces who supported King James in Ireland. And after the Battle of the Boyne, William of Orange was crossing the River Boyne in a ferry. This is supposed to be the case. I don't know if it's true or not, but it's the story. And the ferryman, who was a poor Irish peasant, didn't know anything about politics or battles or anything like that. He didn't know it was the king. He didn't know it was King William. He said, asked him who won the battle. The reply of William of Orange was as follows. "My man, it matters not to you who won the battle, because afterwards you'll be a poor ferryman just the same. That's what I tell you now. It matters not whether Britain is in or out of the capitalist European Union. You, the working class, will suffer just the same, or you'll suffer a damn sight more if the reactionary Tories get in on this basis. Britain will be sold at bargain prices, starting with the national health of the American capitalists," and so on and so forth. That's so much for the sovereignty of Britain, where Johnson is a bootlicker of American imperialism in general, and Mr. Trump in particular. No. There's no way forward for the British working class on the basis of capitalism, this vicious, unjust, cruel system, which the Tory party represents par excellence. There's no future for you, my friends. No future for the workers and the poor people and the unemployed and the single parents and the black people and the Asians and so on. There's no future for you in a capitalist Britain, whether it's in or out of the European Union. It's entirely a false position. Don't fall for this, my friend. Stand for a class position which must be, above all, the defeat of this reactionary, anti-working class, right-wing conservative government, and the election of a Labour government pledged to genuine socialist policies. The policy undoubtedly represents, Corbyn undoubtedly represents a big step forward. This is the only way to clear the decks for a real transformation of Britain in the interests of the majority of people, people like yourselves, like myself, the working class, the class to which we belong. That is the only way forward for Britain. Let's make a start tomorrow morning by voting massively against Johnson and the Conservatives for a Labour government, and then fight for the implementation of genuine socialist policies.